Welcome to the next episode of Dr. Kamini Rao's Masterclass.
My getting into the police force was a sheer accident.
That's great. Yes.
So it is as if my life had come to an end, because that was my greatest ambition of life.
Okay, from defense to telephones, there's a lot of difference, isn't it? How did you feel about it?
It was a mutual understanding, because police job is 24/7, 365 days. You come in, as you rightly said, it is rewarding, no doubt. The reward is you need to assume it for yourself.
No, but what was his mindset? Did he feel that he did wrong, or he thinks what he did was right?
These people are so radicalized that they are ready to die. And it is believed that they go to Jannat, the heaven, if they die in such kind of work. So he had no remorse, absolutely no remorse. Then you said that public money was wasted, and was there a need for this? He was caught red-handed, he was a known terrorist. There is enough evidence against him. I fully agree with you, but except to the extent that we are a democratic country, we have a constitution, we have a law. Whoever is the criminal, he has to be subjected to the due process of law, given an opportunity to defend himself. And then only after the judiciary comes to the conclusion that he is guilty, he is punished. It could be a death by hanging, or it could be a lifetime imprisonment, or lesser punishment. Your point is valid to the extent that this criminal justice system, the speed at which it moves, is too slow. Justice should, reward and punishment should be instantaneous. You go through the process of the criminal justice system, you go through the process, due process of law, but please expedite it. So if somebody gets punished, like you said, the hospital attack, if that gang which comes and attacks the hospital in an unlawful way, if they are punished within 15 days, you will see that no crime will take place.
Absolutely.
Now,
if absolutely.
It drags for 3 years, 4 years, people lose interest, there is no evidence given, case gets acquitted. An acquittal would mean, whatever I do,
I can do it again. Which is really sad, looking at this kind of things. But having again said about this kasab, I was just thinking that had he not been arrested, Mr. Hoswar, if he had been killed in an encounter, that would have been a better option, isn't it? What did we get out of keeping him arrested and keeping him for 3 years?
See, actually, this is a geopolitical issue. If you kill him in an encounter, they always work on deniability. He was from Pakistan. It was state-sponsored terrorism. How do you justify it in the international, how do you give evidence of it in the international forums?
But even now they deny that Kasab
was... No, Pakistan may deny, but India has incontrovertible evidence, which it can show to the rest of the world. It also shows it to Pakistan. Pakistan denies, keeps denying it. That is a separate matter. That is the habit of Pakistan, and their maybe over years they have specialized in denying. But in order to get a lot more information, it is not just that incident. You need something more. I am sure the airstrikes that took place
in Balakot,
and maybe the army's action in some other terror camps, there would be a lot of elements drawn from his interrogation to understand how it is happening. So to that extent, my opinion was that capturing Kasab was right, interrogating him was right, and then that has given us a lot of information to the state machinery.
Another interesting thing that I've been noticing, Mr. Hoswar, is that the west border of India, whether you take Maharashtra, you take Karnataka, you take Kerala, Gujarat, you find that all these terror outfits are sitting there purely because of the fact that they have the economic power and the education. You find that they all do well in their studies as well. So you have a fair amount of widespread Muslim population as well as the Hindu population. So does all the money that is earned by them spent only on development, or part of that gets into this kind of activities of spreading hatred between religions, and that is how it is actually kept alive?
You are right to a great extent. The west coast of India is far more vibrant than the east coast of India. Right from Gujarat up to Kerala, you will find the societies are different. You always find that the people are more educated, they are economically empowered, they are more vibrant, and the society is far more different. The access to the Gulf is one of the factors where the economy of this coastal area has improved considerably. For that matter, Kerala gets a lot of remittances, much more than its own state revenue. The finances is supported by the remittances from the Gulf countries. So the whole of this west coast is volatile. It is progressive. You will find a huge amount of industrialization that has taken place. The educational sector has grown, the health sector has grown. Along with that, this lack of communal harmony is one thing which has led to terror being predominant on the west coast rather than on the east.
But are you saying that we were thinking that people who are illiterate and who are sort of ignorant are the ones that actually cause terror, and now you are telling me that they are highly intelligent and they have economic power and they are also causing this problem? So it becomes a kind of a dichotomy in a way to say that if you are intelligent you will cause problems, and if you are not intelligent also you will cause problems. So where do you find a solution in this?
Yeah, basically this is radicalization of the youth. See, if you look at a terror organization structure, it is as structured as any government or private sector organization. They have think tanks, they have radicalizers, they have people who give training in weaponry, they train people to go and execute that. So it is a very clear pyramid as to how this happened. And since they are all radicalized and they are fighting for, they think they are fighting for independence, or like all freedom fighters, who have been highly educated. But these are the people who are in this country taking help from outsiders and creating unrest here with the hope that one day the caliphate would extend up to India and that there will be a predominant, the whole world will be Islamic. Somebody has that kind of thing, even whether he is educated or not educated, is bound to fall into that trap. I have seen in the investigation of many of these cases that highly skilled people who have got high degrees, people who are working in huge multinational IT companies, are also the brains behind terror. Not all, small percentage. For instance, the serial blasts in Mumbai were caused by the Indian Mujahideen. But just before the blast would take place, a mail would go to all the media houses, please watch out at 7:30 p.m. today.
Yes.
A message will go much before the blast take place. Now, before the media houses can react to it, the blasts have taken place. How did this message go? Who passed on this message? They have highly trained people who penetrate into the Wi-Fi networks of somebody else. It could be yours, it could be mine. Through that, they send the messages to all the people. Just, it is only to create a sense of fear.
Fear.
Terror is nothing but trying to create, disrupt the life of people and create fear. And thereby draw attention to their cause. That the cause is right or wrong is a separate matter.
But I think, you know, again, just moving away from that as well, the East Coast has a different problem altogether. We talked about the West Coast. The East Coast has a different kind of terror outfit. And they have more of the Hindu outfits as well. You know, the radicals that are there, the right-wing radicals as well. What do you think of that?
I think I would slightly differ here. Mm-hmm. It is not right-wing radical on the East Coast. The whole of the eastern India, right from northeast spreading down, has come under the grip of left-wing extremism, the Naxal activities. Yes. what we call as the red corridor extending from Nepal deep south. Karnataka was also affected to a great extent, but fortunately the state has been able to overcome it, especially the Malnad regions, the coastal regions, the Shimoga, Udupi, Dakshin Kannada district, and extending south deep into Kerala. So it is actually another kind of terror that is the, I don't call it, it's not the right wing, it is the left wing extremism. It is something similar like Islamic terror, but it is the right wing, left wing extremism. It has been there for ages, and the government is trying to tackle this very strongly.
And again, if you look at it, you know, we had a lot of stone pelting in Kashmir. And we also had one of the officers having tied up one of the stone pelters to the jeep and paraded that person, and they were able to take a lot of soldiers in the jeep just because they had actually tied this fellow in front. So I think the police also have, and the army also have to think of ways and means to be able to counteract these people's intelligence as well. But surprisingly, when the demonetization took place, okay, the pelting stopped. So does it mean that a lot of money was even given to stone pelters to throw stones? So when that money dried up because of the demonetization, which was actually done overnight, for some time people were quite shocked. I mean, they didn't get the money. So the stone pelting stopped. Do you think that you would believe this theory?
I too read about this. I have no first-hand information. But then ill-gotten wealth always is a fuel for crime. Either right from Bangalore city, the mafia, the land mafia, or anywhere else, it is always the ill-gotten wealth that fuels crime. So it may not be surprising that stone throwing stopped because there was no money available to be distributed, and that has got to be an unaccounted money.
So that was one thing that we heard. But now again, let's come to a very interesting part, Mr. Hosur. This Veerappan thing. I mean, I also read that you had a near-death kind of mission, the ambush that you went through. Can you explain? Because many of your colleagues thought you were dead and just went away, and you had been missing, and your car also had a lot of bullets on it. How did that happen? How did that ambush take place?
Yeah, we had volunteered for the anti-Veerappan operations way back in 1992. And when the special task force was constituted between Tamil Nadu and Karnataka, I was inducted into the task force as the deputy commandant of that place. Veerappan operation was very interesting, very challenging, very risky, no doubt. Coming to your point of that specific incident of ambush, 24th May 1993, early morning, I started from the base camp in MM Hills. I did have security of two jeeps, one in front of me, one behind me. After about 15-20 minutes of driving into the on the road, at a particular point, we came under fire. We were taken by shock and surprise. We didn't know that we'd be attacked at that point of time. So anyway, the convoy was moving. The first jeep blew up, and all the six of my colleagues died on the spot. Veerappan and his gang, who were taken vantage positions, hiding themselves behind the rocks and the trees, not visible to naked eyes, normal eyes. They opened fire on my jeep too. My jeep had 27 bullets. They opened fire on the jeep behind me. Luckily, it was a little farther away. There were only two of us in the jeep, myself and the driver. A bullet pierced into my neck. And another bullet hit my driver. His hand was dangling. I did not know the gravity of this bullet hit to me. I gasped for breath. And I believe what doctors who did the surgery later said, that bullet, which was a bullet used for killing elephants, called the Magnum Express bullet, rifle bullet, it had entered into my lungs through the trachea. And I had a huge amount of blood coming out through that hole. My face totally got swollen. there was an emergency operation to shift me from that place by the forces which came to support us. I was first shifted to Mettur, very initial treatment, then to Salem, which is about 40 kilometers away. And everybody thought I was dead because the bullet had hit the neck. Probably they thought it had hit some trachea or artery or something like that. And survival was one in a million. So an emergency tracheostomy was done in Gokulam Hospital in Salem. The bullet could not be removed because probably they did not have the right tools to remove the bullet. So a doctor was flown in from Chennai, Jayalalitha, the chief minister. She sent a minister to the hospital to be there to make arrangements. That doctor came the next day and they removed the bullet. In the process, my trachea and esophagus also got damaged a couple of places. 21 days I stayed there. I reached certain level of stability. And then there was a thought, Mr. Veerappa Moily wanted to shift me to US for higher treatment. But expert doctors, one of my wife's relation is a leading cardiothoracic surgeon in Tampa. His advice was taken and he said he will not survive the journey. The best thing is to get treated here in Karnataka. And that he would advise the doctors. So today I remember with a lot of gratitude Dr. Nityan Shetty. He's no more with us. Mm-hmm. His photo adorns my table and every time I look at it, I would say he was the man who made me to live. Surgeries were done, but I shifted to St. John's Hospital. I was stayed put there for 6 months.
6 months?
Yes, six major surgeries took place. Mm-hmm. Tracheostomy was done twice. Thoracotomy was done. Plastic surgery was done. Jejunostomy, I used to be on a feeding for about more than 3.5 months. My one vocal cord was permanently damaged. Mm-hmm. And about 10-12 tubes entering into me and 10-12 tubes leaving my body, could not move, bed sores, you name the thing. All this happened and I just married for 4 years. My elder son was 5 years, my elder son was 4 years, younger son was 3 months. Each surgery would start at 6:30 in the morning and extend up to 4-5 p.m. in the evening. And my wife, my mother, relatives would be waiting outside the operation theater. With a lot of anxiety. But God was kind.
It's not God was kind. You've done so much for the public.
No, I would rate the doctors. The doctors who treated me took calculated risks in doing the surgeries, which generally are not done. But Nityan Shetty and his team of cardiothoracic doctors, the cardiologist, the ENT doctors, and gastro doctors, I think they gave total care to me and the government stood by me. Come what may, whatever is the cost, government will take care of it. We want you to survive. So after 6 months, I walked out of the hospital, continued my journey in the police. There afterwards, I had had 16 encounters.
After that,
when
so
I took
charge. So this is what I say, why be ordinary?
After that, I had 16 encounters because I began to feel, of course, I was a changed man. I was a very aggressive officer till then. I became compassionate.
Why do you say you became compassionate?
Compassionate because I used to feel that aggression in all circumstances is not the right thing. So I became cooler. Otherwise I used to be called a very, very aggressive officer. I would take more risks. But thereafter also, I became more mature. I began to think more. And all the police work that I did there afterwards has also given me a huge amount of satisfaction. And even to this date, 7 years into retirement, I cherish my police life. And I think I did the right thing by joining the police. Policing gave me a lot of satisfaction because you are able to leave apart these encounters, leave apart these heroic acts, able to help a common man who is helpless. Somebody who comes without any recommendation, not a rich man, suit boot man, not somebody who brings sifaris and all that. No, a man who walks into my office with a genuine problem, If you can extend an helping hand to him, I think that is far more bigger, better than any of the medals that I have received in my service.
Which is excellent, because this is what the viewers must see. Because, you know, everyone feels that when there is a person of your caliber, that they will all feel that they need to have influence to come and see you. Even when I wanted to get an interview with you and say that I want to interview you, you readily agreed. And I said, this is what I want. Why be ordinary when you're...
Who will not agree for an interview with Dr. Kamini Rao, you tell me.
No, but I like this point of yours that after so many surgeries and so many months in the hospital, you said you owe it to the doctors. What I would say is that as providence, see, the God cannot be everywhere. He either creates a mother, he creates a doctor. So through some acts, God comes in some kind of form and helps you, because he knows that you have a lot more unfinished things to do to the community, and therefore he got you back. And like they say, you know, this is your second life and that's why you're going to be achieving more things. Therefore your mindset changed, which was again for the good, and you started thinking more rationally. So it was thinking now with the heart rather than only the mind. And so that heart murmur, for which you did not get into the army, it really did wonders for you today. It has made you a much more mature person in your own words. And of course now you look at the common man and you look at it differently. And I think these are all positive signs. And I would not say that nothing happens by accident. It's all decided by fate. And this is how I would look at it and say,
somebody of your accomplishment saying this, I have to accept it. I will accept it.
It is important, sir, because I see that. And another interesting thing that I see, this Veerappan thing is something that has really interested me. Here is a man, a brigand, who really doesn't have that kind of a power. He must be having about a handful of his group walking around with bows and arrows in the olden days kind of this thing. And see, you know, primitive kind of gadgets, or you may call, say, bow and arrow kind of things, or some handmade grenades, etc. And the entire police force was not able to locate. And I understand that the topography was not good and we were not able to locate that fellow for a long time, and it was almost like a guerrilla warfare. Do you think, you know, looking back on this operations, we could have done better in Karnataka? What went wrong?
Yeah, if a thing can be done, it can always be done better. Veerappan's end no doubt came, but it is necessary for us to introspect. As you rightly said, could we have done better? Where did we fail? God forbid if there is one more Veerappan, would we be reinventing the wheel? So these are the issues which have also engaged my mind for quite some time. This is a protracted operation of about 18 years. Hardly in history you find this kind of characters. There have been characters, if not that, Geronimo and so many others were there, Pablo and all were there across the world, who defied the established order, who took the challenged the state, survived. And in a couple of cases, there were negotiations to settle the issues, even with such characters. But fortunately, in case of Veerappan, it did not happen. Finally, he was killed in an encounter. But what you rightly said, see, this was a totally new experience for the Karnataka police. They were at best good in urban policing or rural policing, but they had never ever entered the forest. Or even if they had entered the forest, it was only to sandalwood smugglers or timber smugglers or somebody who would shoot a wildlife. Only for that limited purpose they used to go. Such organized brigand, such organized gang of notorious criminals, the Karnataka police had never ever earlier encountered. So they had to learn everything on the job. And that job would mean that you need to know the topography of the forest. And forest is such a thing, I'm sure if you would have gone for some treks and all that, within 30-40 meters you can lose your way. Just lose your way. You won't know where you are heading, you won't know the directions, and you won't know the paths. So unless unlike the cities, at least the houses are numbered, the roads are named. In the forest, nothing of that kind. Only a man who has actually walked inside the forest for years together, you'll be able to find the path. Somebody going new, he'll just get lost within 15 minutes. Now this was the first challenge. Number two, Veerappan is a product of that village, product of the forest. He knew the forest like the back of his hand. He could traverse long distances through shortcuts. He knew the people well there. He was like a Robin Hood kind of person. He would declare to the people that he is their savior, not the police. And he also added an element of fear by ruthless killing of people who wanted to inform the police. Any number of people here, hundreds of people he has killed, shot them dead, right in the presence of the villagers, and challenged the villages. So this is the kind of person who knows the topography well, even if he has limited weapon system. That's what I said. His intelligence network, his intelligence system was far ahead of that of the STF. He knew the movement of STF better because he had informants. The STF had run, the intelligence sources of the STF had run dry. So getting that correct intelligence about the location of Veerappan was something which failed the police right through the operation.
So are you saying it's a massive intelligence failure?
No, okay. Now again, intelligence failure, I would say, unlike today, there is no technology of drones, there is no technology of communication, there are no satellite images and modern gadgets which are useful. Like when Osama bin Laden was finally killed by the American forces in Abbottabad, technology was heavily used. No doubt human intelligence was also used. Human intelligence was an important component of any intelligence system. But technological intelligence, they relied on it because they were advanced. In the same way, in anti-Veerappan operations, there was no consistency. We reacted to incidents rather than chasing him, rather than we are giving him opportunities to attack, and our counterattacks were not as effective, fast enough. So a criminal fears only when he is chased, otherwise he will chase the police. So in the Veerappan operation also, it got delayed because of that. But our experience now is far better. We now know if a similar situation arises. But my fear today is not Veerappan in the forest, Veerappan in the cyber world.
Yes.
If somebody can hold the world to ransom through cyber attacks, he would be a much bigger Veerappan than the Veerappan that we are talking of.
Absolutely. In fact, today we are looking at COVID also in that kind of way, which they call as a novel virus. It's only because they're not able to understand this virus, and it's held the world economy and brought it to its knees. Even now they're working on the vaccine. They're not able to get that vaccine correct. And we're also having the second wave and the third wave coming. So clearly, somebody who has actually got into this has thought about it very well and has executed it to perfection. So things like biological warfare, and all these kinds of things are bound to happen. Where I am very sure that this is how it's going to be in future. So not that proverbial, army going into the forest and army going there. This is not going to be there.
Unlikely.
But then, you got into another area, Mr. Hosur, and I was very interested. You've come into my field, and that is the healthcare. And it is something which you've not hesitated to experiment, and you've used your skills in these places, the skills that you learnt as a police officer, and you joined as a CEO of Chinmaya Mission Hospital, That's a very good, noble hospital, which is a trust hospital, serving the poor and needy. And you were able to manage the employees over there. Would you like to tell us how you managed to do that? Because many more hospitals would like to learn from you.
Yeah, I think one of the very interesting chapters of my professional life post police has been working as the chief executive of a hospital. I had visited hospital either as a patient or carried somebody, some patient to the hospital to meet the doctor. Beyond that, I had absolutely no knowledge. But sitting on the chair of the chief executive, I think destiny had it in me that I should go there. Otherwise, in terms of qualification, I am nowhere to be in that position. So working in that hospital has broadened my understanding of the medical field, the kind of challenges the medical field faces, the kind of challenges the hospitals face. Every day is a learning experience for me. I may have handled mobs, crimes, criminals, terror, Naxals and all that. But sitting as the chief executive of a hospital is actually as challenging as a police job. Since you have been such well-known doctor with so much of experience and name, I'm sure you understand that the medical field is as challenging or more challenging than the police, because police only deal with crime and criminals. You deal with everybody, right from birth till they go to the grave. You deal with them, and running a hospital has been a very, very interesting challenge, because today's hospitals are unlike the past, are technology driven. There is a huge amount of IT activity that takes place in a hospital. How a pharmacy is run, how a front office is run, how housekeeping happens, how the lab is run, doctors, nurses, ICU, so many things. Especially during the COVID time, we had to spend a lot of time and energy on creating 100 beds, improving the ICU, getting ventilators, a hospital for profit. Whatever money is that comes in, it goes to maintain the hospital and run the hospital. So it has been a very interesting. So as it happens everywhere, there are people who are disgruntled, who think they can take the management, hold the management to ransom. I said, nothing doing. This cannot be permitted. We will give you the best of the facilities that are available anywhere in the state or in any other hospital. You need to work. And there is no question. On issues not connected with management, you will have no say. Issues connected with the workmen, yes, there is a mechanism for adjudication. There is a mechanism to sort out the issues. There are fixed guidelines. But if somebody violates it, the management cannot be a spectator. So I had to be a bit tough. I had to, with iron fist, I had to handle it. Fortunately, the workers also realized their folly. They came back to work. Hospital is running well, and things are peaceful. Doctors, nurses are not threatened anymore.
Which is really good, because sometimes what happens, doctors, when they become administrators, they become soft. And this is taken advantage by the employees. And when you say, oh, yo, papa, let us do this, and then they take advantage of it. And many times, you know, we are caught from this angle to that angle because we are looking at from a human side. Sometimes, you know, the carrot and stick kind of story has to be in proportion used so that, you know, they also understand discipline is very important in life.
No, one advantage for me was that I had worked in the government.
Yes.
I'd handled law and order situations. I knew the civil society around, which comes to the support of the deviant people, the outfits, the fringe elements. So I knew this, I knew the psychology of these people, and also whether the political establishment stands by you. No doubt, under the law, the police is supposed to stand by you, the government is supposed to stand by you. But then, having worked in the government, knowing, having known how the government works, having built a certain amount of reputation, network, goodwill, I think that also helped us a lot. So I would say that most hospital administrators need to follow this very clear line that you shall know the employee, what he does in the hospital, also what he does outside. And if he's doing things which are not in the interest of the hospital, I would say that he should be dealt with appropriately. There is no question, and this does not mean that you should not be sympathetic. You need to be extremely sympathetic, you need to be helpful to them, you should provide them the best possible support that you can give to that, because on each employee depends 3 family members. So if we deal with this employee, you are also hurting those 3 members. This employee should know this. The day I am dealt with, my wife, my children are going to suffer, their education is going to suffer, they are not going to get free medical treatment, they are not going to get subsidized medicines, his parents will not get. And that the point that he has been suspended itself is a stigma in the society that he moves around, not just in the hospital, outside. So these things the management has to very clearly, while being sympathetic, hearing their grievances, solving as many as is possible, but at no point of time they can hold the management by the neck by wrong methods.
Yes, I think that's right. Basically, to nip it in the bud. Don't allow it to become so big that, you know, the employees run the institution rather than the institution, you know, runs the employees.
Tail wagging the head.
Now, another thing I wanted to look at, your social service activities. You've done the trust that is the Samara, as well as, you know, the Sankalp that you've done. Now, can you explain something about this Samara?
Yeah, Samara is a trust. Actually, it was intended, but it has still not taken off. But more important is what you mentioned, Sankalpa. And the other one is Matrushri Manovikasa Kendra, which is very close to this place. And the third is, I am the president of the Swimming Association, Karnataka Swimming Association. So these are things which keep me fully engaged right through the day, morning to night. Coming back to this also give me a lot of satisfaction, but right in the heart of city in Seshadripuram, we have a place where children who are orphans, who are mentally retarded, who are nobody there to challenge, differently challenged, nobody is there to take care, we pick them up. So we have about 130 children taken care of 24/7, 365 days a year, with proper medical support system, with the help of charity given by people, ATG exemption, and governments also give them some money to run this institution. So last 5-6 years I'm presiding over that institution. So this gives me a huge amount of satisfaction. Anybody coming to me, I would request them to visit that place. If they are satisfied, contribute and see the work and then contribute, rather than just because I am telling them. The second is that I also work with the prison inmates.
Yes.
So there are a lot of prisoners who have committed crime, not intending to commit it, but on the spur of the moment. An emotional crime, like a brother murdering another brother over a small dispute. He didn't intend to do it, but then he suddenly took the sickle and hit him and he died. He's convicted, he's in prison. Now, how do you make this man's, when after release, to seamlessly merge with the society and get back his standing? So fortunately for me, Mr. M.P. Prakash, then minister, he put me into this, and Mr. Hulgappa Kattimani from Rangayana, Mysore. We initiated this in 1997. And Hulgappa Kattimani trains the prison inmates into fine arts and into theater.
Excellent.
So over the last 23 years, we have trained hundreds of life convicts, and we have enacted more than about 15 dramas, and those dramas are enacted in public space, not inside the prison. The prisoners are taken to a public space like Chowdhury Memorial Hall or auditorium in the town hall,
Ravindra
Kalakshetra, and they have been taken tour all over the state. We have taken the same troupe to Delhi and played there. We have taken the troupe to Mumbai and played there. We have taken the troupe to Trivandrum and played there. And one of the dramas called Maranayaka, out of 400 dramas which had entered for a competition at the national level, one of them was our drama called Maranayaka, played by prison inmates.
Excellent. See, this is true, because you know, you cannot actually label them as prison inmates and say that you can't do anything. So you are able to get them back to normal, into civil society, and say that don't do this again. Basically reforming them, and that is so important.
Because the aim of the penal law is prison, is to reform a person.
So thank you very much, Mr. Hosur, because it has been an enlightening conversation with you. It's given us so much of information that we never knew, and I'm sure my viewers didn't know. But I would like to get your thoughts on what you would like to tell my viewers, because the masterclass is all about why be ordinary when you can be extraordinary. So your thoughts, Mr. Hosur, to my viewers.
Yeah, first and foremost, Dr. Kamini Rao and her team initiating this masterclass at the time of the pandemic is something really, it gives me a lot of happiness. Very few people get into some creative activity for the society, and you have taken this initiative, and I am sure your viewers who would have seen earlier episodes would have understood the importance, and it carries some message to the people. I must congratulate you and thank you for getting me on to this program. It has also been a great education to me interacting with you, though I had heard your name a lot, not met you in person. One thing I can say is that we need to make our life interesting. There are enough problems to get morose, and those problems automatically go away provided we hold the bull by its horn. A bit of courage, not being subdued by problems which we face in our daily lives. Just get up, begin to work, and fill the whole day with one activity or the other, so that when you go and lie down on the bed, you are physically tired, you feel like sleeping, and you will get a good sleep. So a bit of concern for the people around you, especially the poor, the have-nots, wherever you can extend a helping hand to them, I think that would give you a lot of satisfaction. At least it has given me a lot of satisfaction in my own life. And I recall with a lot of affection the love people gave me when I was in service, and it was generally the people who were have-nots. So I think we need to take care of people around us, help the society, remain active right through, and overcome the difficulties that come our path. Thank you, madam.
Thank you very much. So, we come to the end of another episode of Dr. Kamini Rao's Masterclass. You've heard this excellent deliberation by Mr. Gopal Hosur. Whoever believed that a police officer can be so soft, and a person with courage, and a person who is not afraid, but who will kill every fear and overcome it, and that is what he is trying to tell you. You may not be chasing Veerappan, you may not be chasing any other brigands, but your own fears, devils in your own mind, you have to just pull up your socks, get up and just do it. And that is what Mr. Gopal Hosur has told you. A 360 degree view introspect that extraordinary is within you and nobody else. Thank you very much for watching this show. Coming soon with the next episode, Dr. Kamini Rao's Masterclass.
So we all are talented individuals and it's never too late to start. You can be 10 years old, you can be 50 years old, but you have the talent, and if you put your mind into it and if you focus and motivate yourself, you can do it and you will do it.